Welcome to this presentation from the Urban Penguin. My name is Andrew Mallett, and today we're going to take a look at topic 1.4 of the LPI Linux Essentials certification, looking at the ICT skills necessary for working with Linux. As always, you can find these videos on theurbanpenguin.com, and you can follow me on Twitter at theurbanpenguin. In this presentation for the LPI Linux Essentials, we're going to take a look at some of the ICT skills that you're going to require and some of the places that you're going to find Linux in today's industry. So we're going to start taking a look at some of the desktop skills that you need, how we access the command line, so the different ways that we can access the command line in Linux, and looking at some of the industry uses of Linux and cloud computing and virtualization. One of the first things we're going to have to identify with our desktop skills is the different types of Windows managers. We now no longer got a vendor-supplied operating system that comes with a standard Windows system. We're going to have different windowing systems or Windows managers, such as KDE, Gnome, and Unity. Of course, we've got to understand how to log in and log out, how to use the browser, set some of our configuration options. For our users, of course, they're going to have to know how to change their passwords. They're going to have to understand permissions, and we in desktop support are going to have to be able to help them with this. And of course, we've got to look at some of the open source applications they might be using, such as a replacement for your own Office suite. So accessing the command line, we can access the command line through terminals, through consoles, and through SSH. So we'll look at these different mechanisms that we can use for accessing our command line interface, or CLI. Some of the industry uses for Linux. So we're going to find that Linux is commonly used in a lot of organizations, if not most organizations, as servers. Some organizations will also use it as their desktops, and some individuals within organizations would prefer to have Linux as their desktops. Virtualization hosts such as Citrix XenServer are also Linux-based, as are many virtual appliances that we might use. Virtual appliances are just virtual machines that will run in VMware or XenServer, and very often they too are Linux-based. So we're going to find Linux used more often than not, and almost all industries today are going to be using Linux in some shape or form. Especially to pick up some of the desktop skills. It's like anything, even with using Windows or Macs, you have to be familiar with it yourself. So ideally, you'll be using Linux at home within your college. If you can't use it on a physical machine, then consider virtualization technologies such as VirtualBox that can install on top of Windows, or VMware's VMware Player, both of which are free and can host then your Linux operating system for you on top of Windows. So we're starting our journey on a CentOS 5.8 machine that happens to use a GNOME desktop. Within the GNOME desktop, we happen to have the application menu at the top and our workspace switcher towards the bottom. But even in different distributions, GNOME can be configured differently. So I can move up to my applications and I can access my applications through the applications menu. And in the bottom right hand corner, I've got my workspace switcher, where I can then leave applications open on my desktop and switch between them without them cluttering my desktop space. CentOS ships with the Office suite OpenOffice, and I can fire up OpenOffice Calc. You might vaguely say this is familiar to Microsoft's Office product, Excel, so it's a spreadsheet. And of course, if we're used to using spreadsheet programs, we're going to find it very similar. So I can just put a whole load of numbers into column A, and then if I want to add them all up together, I can go into column B, and we can do something like equals and then sum, and then in my brackets cell A1 through to A10 or whatever, and then a little tick to run the calculations. So of course I could go through and save this from the file menu. And again, there's no real difference using these graphical based applications. They are all vaguely the same, but we can see what we can do in Excel, we can probably do within OpenOffice Calc. But if I move across to my workspace switcher, we can see that I can open up a new clean desktop and leave calc running, and I can fire up at other applications. Might even just go through and navigate through to the file browser and start navigating through the file system. So this is looking at my desktop. I can go through and close that. If I need to open up other places, I can go down to the bottom and navigate up to the root file system. And we can see that some directories I will have access to. Other directories like the lost and found and the root user's home directory have a big no entry sign. And that's actually saying I don't have permissions into those folders. So navigating the file system again doesn't have to be that different from anything else, and I can switch back with the workspace switcher straight into my calc program and switching back then into my file browser. So this is just giving you the idea of Gnome. If I want to log out from here, then I can go to system and I can log out or shut it down, and it will take me back to the Gnome login screen. So welcome to Ubuntu and the Unity desktop. You'll see why it's called Unity in a few moments. This is using Ubuntu 12.10, so it's one of the very latest releases. And if I fire up my web browser, the Firefox browser, which you're going to find on most distributions, the term Unity really comes from the fact that once I open up an application, then the Unity toolbar takes on the identity of that application's menuing bar. I can see this is the Unity bar because moving across to the right, I've got my normal controls, my sound, my wireless, my login, my logout. But then moving back to the left-hand side, we've got now focus on the Unity menu for Firefox. I can close my application down through the little red X, and this might be familiar to Mac OS X users who have a very similar system. In Ubuntu, they use LibreOffice, which is a fork of OpenOffice, so they're very similar software. They've just forked and gone in slightly separate directions. And in LibreOffice Impress, it's very much like a presentation or PowerPoint product where I can then go through and create slideshows and use these in my presentations. So without spending a lot of time or effort on this, I can go through and create a title slide. And once I've got all that up and running, obviously I could add other slides and other slide types to it. But then when I'm ready, I can go into my slide presentation. You might be familiar with other packages, and it is the same F5 key that takes you into a slideshow, and escape that would jump out of the slideshow. When I go back up to my Unity toolbar, I can then go through and save the application. And when I look at the file types that I can save it as the native file types for LibreOffice. So I can choose where to store it, obviously, so I can go through and put this into my documents directory. But if I look at the formats we can store it in, we can store it in the Open Document Foundation format, or even in Microsoft PPTX formats. We'll just save it in the normal format. And this gives you an idea of using Unity on Ubuntu and Impress. So if those desktops aren't enough for you, let's take a look at KDE on my OpenSUSE 12.3 desktop. With OpenSUSE, I can then access my menu bar through the SUSE icon in the left-hand corner, and we can go through and access my applications and favorites. I can browse through settings on my computer. One of the nice things in SUSE is that they have a utility called YAST, yet another setup tool, and this becomes a global control center for the machine. You will need root privileges to be able to access it, so you need to know the root user's password, the administrator of the machine. But it puts all of the administration tools, the graphical administration tools, into one place, whether that's managing software and our software repositories, or managing our hardware, or managing system settings, or looking at our user management. So that includes then the firewall, user and group management, setting up and delegating control through sudo. So graphical interfaces to all of these. We can move into our network services, and I can start configuring my network servers and my network devices, setting up my network cards, the IP address, configuration, etc. Jumping back to the security and users, I can move down to user and group management, and I can go through and create my users here, or I could edit existing ones, which could include resetting their password. I can also change the password from the command line, and we'll look at that in a few moments from another system. So that's done for a while within YARS, but I do like the YARS graphical tool, so we can close this out. And moving back then, right-clicking on the desktop, users can configure their own desktops by running commands, adding in widgets, clocks, timers, those sorts of things. Or they can change their default settings, so setting up their screen background, or the way their mouse is going to behave. So once we're finished with this, we can close this down, and then moving back, we can see that we can access our applications, and the Office suite that ships with OpenSUSE is LibreOffice. And again, we can fire up the word processor. So of course, this is going to allow me to create typed up documents, and I can save them in different formats and export them as PDF documents if necessary. So it's a good way of sending out your CV as a PDF. But we can then go through and write the document. So this is the life of a penguin, and we can see we've got the export directly as PDF, so we can save this as a PDF file. And then of course, once we've finished with the application, we can quit out of it. It's going to prompt me to save, because even though I've exported it as a PDF, I haven't saved it. And we can save it in the default format, again from the Open Document Foundation. So with that shut down, we can start looking at some other things that we can do within Linux. Usually we have some form of graphical terminal that we're able to open. So if we are running Unity, or if we're running Gnome, or in this case KDE, we normally have some level of command line that we can get to through a graphical console. As we saw before, I can use a Control Shift Plus to make my font bigger, because this is a graphical application. We're not stuck to a fixed font size or something like that. Also, if I have multiple terminals open, I can use cut and paste. But we still maintain on the physical server, if we have access to the physical server or the physical desktop, we actually have terminals themselves, so TTYs. If I choose Control Alt and then F1, it can take me through to the F1 or TTY1 console, and of course I can log on to this console. Hitting F2, Control Alt F2, would take me to the F2 console. To get back to my graphical console again, that's going to be Control Alt and F7. So we have both the graphical consoles, but we also have our physical consoles that we can access from the device itself. But of course, this is not the only way we can access the command line. You might also be using Windows hosts and need to be able to access your servers or desktops command line remotely, and we can do that through the SSH client PuTTY. This is a free download and open source software that you can use, and that can gain you SSH access to the server's console. So using PuTTY from Windows, I can then connect to my host. So we can see this is the PuTTY tool running from a Windows machine. And I can load saved configurations and then open the SSH connection to this. So this is now giving me a secure shell connection to my SSH server. And we can type in then my password. And this is giving me secure remote access to the console on the server. So once I've logged in, if I want to do anything administratively, I could use sudo or I could use su to switch to the root user's account if I have the root user's password. So su for switch user, and type in the password of the user that I'm switching to. If I don't put a username, it assumes I'm switching to root. User accounts are stored in the etc password file, so passwd. We can see that I've got a user here called user1. Or maybe that user's forgotten their password, so I can use the password command running as root to reset a user's password. So I'm not being prompted for their original password, I just have to set their new password. It's warning me this is a simple password, I'm just setting it to password, but it will allow me to set it, but it won't allow an ordinary user to store a non-secure password. The passwords are not actually stored in the password file, but they're stored in the shadow file. So etc shadow is where the user's passwords are stored. The user configuration is in the password file. So that gives you an idea of how you can access the command line in Linux. And finally for this section, we're going to look at the importance of Linux within your enterprise organization. Here we're looking at the Citrix XenCenter, which manages the XenServer virtualization hosts. So if I move through to the virtualization host and look at its console, it is in fact running Linux underneath. The virtualization host will host the virtual machines, and many of the virtual machines as well will be using Linux. But if I type in ps, we can see that I'm using the bash shell, the bash command line, and if I use the command uname, we can see that it is in fact the operating system we're using is Linux. And as I say, much of the virtual appliances that you will run both in VMware and in XenServer are going to be based around Linux. So it isn't just on your main servers where you're expecting to find Linux, you're going to find it on your utility servers such as our virtualization host. Linux is important and will continue to be important in your ICT career. Here we're just giving you some of the examples of where Linux can be used and what Linux can do for you both at home and in the office enterprise.